HarperCollins presents Her Daughter's Secret by Lisa Timoney. Read by Rachel Atkins. To my mum, Bronwyn, for everything. Kiss. Now. Chapter 1. B didn't fit in here. For a start, it was a long time since she'd had egg-shaped buttocks like the other mothers in the playground. Hers probably looked like two hot cross buns squashed at the bottom of a carrier bag. She tugged down her sleeves to warm her hands, her gaze fixed on the double doors, trying not to imagine how Phoebe must feel when she watched all her classmates skip towards their mothers. Eventually, Phoebe appeared, flanked by the classroom assistant, Kelly. B rushed to greet her. Auntie B! Her niece held out her arms, and B crouched down, wrapping her in a hug.
I didn't know you were coming today.
B pulled back, looking into Phoebe's face. The birthmark covering most of her right cheek and eyelid was livid against the rest of her pale skin. She wondered if Phoebe was tired or cold, since it was a darker red than usual.
I'm doing early shifts this week, so I can pick you up.
Planting a kiss on Phoebe's dark hair, she stood, feeling her knees creak with the effort. She smiled at Kelly.
All okay today?
There was a bit of unpleasantness, but we dealt with it, didn't we?
Kelly rubbed the top of Phoebe's head, seemingly oblivious to the little girl's grimace. Phoebe reached up to flatten her hair. B stiffened.
Anything I need to tell her dad?
It's fine.
Phoebe flapped a dismissive arm and set off across the playground.
We're on it,
Kelly said, touching B lightly on the wrist before turning and heading back inside. By the time they reached B's old Yaris, the car park was almost empty of the SUVs and sports cars that usually jostled for space.
Blimey! What did you have for lunch? Lead weights?
B groaned as she lifted Phoebe into the passenger seat, and the little girl giggled, stopping when B leaned over to pull the seatbelt across.
I can do it, she said, a note of defiance in her voice.
B smoothed down the maroon tunic she hadn't changed out of since her shift at Sweetingdale, and stood back, listening for the click. The memory of a passenger in another car, where the seatbelt hadn't been done up, made her wonder if she'd ever see Phoebe in a car without the ghost of her mother coming along for the ride. When they arrived at Phoebe's home, Bea switched off the alarm, standing aside to let her niece skip past the glass-encased staircase, which would have a permanent mosaic of sticky fingerprints if Bea didn't know how to wield a microfiber cloth. She kicked off her trainers, popping them into the cupboard hidden under the stairs. The temptation to abandon them on the polished wood floor was strong. It would be funny to watch the consternation on Ewan's face when he came home to a house that didn't look like something from an interior design magazine.
Homework, said B, with a mock stern voice, following Phoebe to the kitchen.
She deliberately slapped the satchel onto the white table and made Phoebe jump. The little girl sniggered.
It's smellings today, isn't it?
She remembered Immy at the same age as Phoebe, giggling when she told B she'd accidentally called spellings smellings in front of her teacher. The memory stung the back of her eyes for a moment before she blinked it away. She opened the kitchen drawer where Ewan kept the stationery. It was neater than any in B's house, the pens, pencils and felt tips all segregated like knives and forks in a cutlery drawer. Plucking out a sharp pencil, she pointed at one of the emerald velvet dining chairs.
Come on.
Phoebe clambered onto the chair and opened a page with a list of 10 printed words glued in.
These smellings are easy, she said. I can do all of them with my eyes shut.
Let's see if you can.
Bea could still recall the distress on her husband Ollie's face when Ewan called to tell them why his beautiful baby had started having seizures. A brain scan had revealed that the birthmarks covering much of the right side of Phoebe's face and upper body were also on the occipital lobe of her brain. She shoved the memory back, concentrating on the bright, funny girl at the table. Taking her scarf from the bottom of her bag, she picked off the sweet wrappers that were stuck to it and gently blindfolded Phoebe, who squealed in delight. She wrote the words with her eyes closed, then said them out loud before Bea relented and put the book back in the bag. Placing the pencil back into the slot with the felt tips, she slid the drawer closed.
Want to help make dinner?
What are we having?
Your daddy asked me to make fish pie and salad. She lowered her voice. But I'm not allowed to add any chilli to the dressing because we don't want to.
She let the sentence hang, watching Phoebe's eyes dance as they both said, blow Grandma's head off, and laughed at the familiar joke. She doubted Joyce would find it funny. What would her mother-in-law find funny? Maybe next door's cat being run over so it couldn't crap on her lawn. Opening the fridge, she felt her smile chill in the cold air. In the last year, she had gone from occasionally picking Phoebe up from school and making her something to eat to frequently making dinner for Ewan too. Recently, his text asked if she'd mind making enough for Joyce and taking it down to her house.
If it wasn't too much trouble.
Phoebe's chatter was like soothing music as she nibbled on the fish pie. This was the highlight of Bee's day. When she finished her last mouthful, Bea leaned her elbows on the table and yawned.
Am I keeping you up? Phoebe asked.
It was as though her grandmother's words were coming out of the six-year-old's mouth.
I'm a bit tired. I was in the shower by 5 this morning. Then I did an 8-hour shift before collecting you from school.
Phoebe's eyebrows dipped in the middle.
Does that mean you won't come and get me any more?
Bea sat up straight, forcing her eyes wide.
Don't be daft. I want to pick you up. It's my favourite thing to do. I'd only be at home on my own if I wasn't here, and that would be no fun, would it?
I like it when you say daft like that.
Well, it's not daft, is it? There's no R in it. You sound like Immy taking the mickey out of my accent.
Phoebe's gaze dropped to the floor. Bea froze, then busied herself plating up 2 meals for Ewan and Joyce. She made sure 3/4 of Joyce's plate was made up of salad, with the merest gloss of light vinaigrette.
Heaven forbid the woman should be exposed to too many carbohydrates. They were for people with poor self-control, apparently.
She covered the plate and prepared to take it outside, down the gravel drive, past the 2 neighbouring houses, and into the beautiful arts and crafts house her husband grew up in, and which her mother-in-law still presided over, like queen of the bloody crescent. As she bent to slide on her shoes, her eyes rested on the photograph on the hall table. Any feelings of resentment about how much she was expected to give to this family melted away when she saw a 3-year-old Phoebe wrapped in the arms of a stunning young woman who shared the same bright eyes and blunt brown fringe as the little girl. Gemma's chin rested on Phoebe's tiny shoulder. Her creamy cheek nestled against the bright red of her daughter's as they smiled identical, beautiful smiles. Bea stood up and hugged Phoebe tightly to her.
What's that for?
Phoebe's voice was muffled against her tunic. Softening her hold, Bea took her niece's face in her hands.
I just love you, that's all.
But that wasn't all. That wasn't nearly half of it. But she couldn't say how sorry she was, how much she wished she'd been a better mother to Immy. If she had been, she was sure things would have turned out differently. She lifted the plate and trudged down the road to make one of a million amends that would never amount to enough. Chapter 2. The plate was too hot to hold comfortably. Bee swapped it to her other hand as she and Phoebe waited on Joyce's doorstep in the miserable autumn drizzle. Joyce opened her front door and smiled, or at least gave her version of a smile, which was a minute drawing back of her ruby lips and the narrowing of her blue-lidded eyes. Joyce had worn the same style of makeup for the 27 years Bee had known her. Now 80, the black coal along her upper lid was sometimes shaky, and the red lipstick bled into the lines around her mouth. But with the tight plait wound around her head, grey, where once it was chestnut brown, it was still a strong look. A strong look for a strong woman.
"Fish pie?" she asked, nodding towards the plate as Bee and Phoebe stepped into the wood-panelled hallway. "How nice."
Bee rolled her eyes at this pretense at surprise and wondered why Joyce bothered. They both knew Bee would follow orders. She was like a broken-in horse, keeping her kick firmly under control. She never deviated from what Ewan suggested in his texts. She never reared up and showed her teeth. This was her penance for what had happened 3 years ago. She knew it was the least she could do. Joyce's march was slower than usual, her gait uneven, as they wiped their feet, then followed her past the grandfather clock into the kitchen.
"Your leg all right? You limping?"
"I'm perfectly fine."
Joyce's back straightened. Bee put the plate on a slate mat that sat lonely on the table.
"Would you like us to sit with you while you eat?"
She took the cellophane from the plate, the delicious smell of the pie wafting up with the steam.
"No, thank you. I'm used to my own company."
Joyce peered at the plate.
"Prawns?"
"It's nice, Grandma," said Phoebe. "I ate all mine, didn't I, Auntie Bee?"
Bee touched her niece's head, wondering how Joyce could resist scooping her into a hug whenever she saw her. She remembered Joyce telling her to leave Immy to cry when she woke in the night as a baby, and her saying how Bee had spoiled her by picking her up when she raised her pudgy arms towards her as a toddler. Guilt crept over her skull as she remembered how sometimes, when they visited Joyce, she'd fought her instincts and let her child cry. She wondered if the wails of her infant daughter had been absorbed by the wood lining these walls. Maybe that was why she hated being here so much, or at least partly why. She rested her arm around Phoebe's shoulders.
"You did really well, Poppet."
"Prawns have no place in a fish pie."
Joyce scraped the curled pink creature to the side of the plate and dug under the potato, examining the creamy filling.
"I think they add something," said Bee, grabbing the prawn and popping it into her mouth, not looking at Joyce.
A small amount of rebellion before she returned to her stall. She picked up yesterday's clean plate from next to the porcelain sink and gestured to Phoebe to follow her back to the hall.
"Enjoy your dinner. Can you take the rubbish out with you, Beatrice?" called Joyce. "It's behind the door."
Bee widened her eyes at her niece, and Phoebe covered her mouth with her hand to stop her giggles, as Bee said,
"No problem."
She dipped back into the kitchen and grabbed the black sack. She swerved around the side of the house and dumped the bag in the wheelie bin, jumping out of the way of the rainwater sloshing off the lid. She peered up at the dormer window above the garage, feeling a familiar twinge of longing, imagining Ollie's face at the window after he came back from travelling, when, to save falling back into the old patterns of doing whatever his mother dictated, he'd moved into the room above the garage while he did his postgraduate teaching course. It was the first place Bee had stayed with him in Belmote. She'd travelled down from Yorkshire to meet his family and stayed in that chilly room as he tried to persuade her his mother did like her, that her snootiness was just a facade. If that was so, it was a heavily fortified facade. Bee had only ever seen through it when she'd interrupted Joyce playing with Immy as a young girl. But as soon as Immy stopped being compliant and golden, the barriers went back up. Years later, Even Phoebe couldn't get past them. As she walked back to the front of the house, she clocked Phoebe's screwed-up face as though she was grappling with a difficult question. In response to Bee's questioning look, she said,
"I found something in my craft box. Do you want to see when we get home? What is it?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.